Thank you very much, Dr. Upur. And thank you very much, Ms. Salim and Madam Padma Gunaratna, for giving me this opportunity to present. Now, hematuria is a very common problem that we encounter both in medical and surgical specialties. Now, just to show the importance of proper evaluation of hematuria, I would like to start with a short case history of a real patient that we came across about 3 years ago during our practice. Now, this was a healthy male without any previous medical problems who has gone to a general practitioner with a single episode of visible hematuria, what you call gross hematuria. And at that time, the urine full report has shown moderately filled red cells. And well, as usual, he was treated with a course of antibiotics. And the good thing was he was referred to us for a second opinion. In the history, he said he has worked in abroad for about 2 years handling chemicals, but he was unclear what chemicals he has handled. Examination was unremarkable, and we repeated the sample of urine field report repeated was normal. We reassess him with baseline serum creatinine, which was normal, full blood count was normal. We sent a sample of urine for cytology, which also was negative, and we ordered a departmental ultrasound scan. Now, in the ultrasound, we could see this little flower coming out of the right lateral wall of the bladder. And in the same setting, he had cystoscopy and transurethral resection of this bladder tumor. And the histology was, it was a non-invasive, low-grade urothelial cancer. Now, nobody would expect a young male to come out with bladder cancer. But if we do not evaluate these patients as per a protocol, we can jolly well miss these patients, because the current day, the natural history of most malignancies especially have changed. And we are coming more and more across young patients coming with malignancies who are supposed to have in our textbooks as 50 to 70 years of age. Now they are coming at this stage. So by definition, hematuria is described in two forms. The first type, when you pee, you can see blood in your urine, which is called visible hematuria. Earlier, it was called gross or macroscopic hematuria. Now, those terms are no longer being used. The term is visible hematuria. Other thing, urine is clear. You check urine full report, then you see the red cells in urine. Now, what is the cutoff point for you to identify it as significant? It should be more than 3 per high power field. Earlier, the cutoff point was more than 5. But the standard currently accepted by American Urological Association is more than 3 per high power field. Now, how come this cutoff point comes? Now, there's a normal rate at which the red cells are escaped into urine. Even at this very high rate, you will not get more than 3 per high power field normally. Now, again, there are two types of hematuria being described: true hematuria and pseudohematuria. Now, true hematuria is you have blood in urine that have originated in the urinary tract. Pseudohematuria can be of two things. One thing, there's blood in urine, but that blood has not originated in the urinary tract. The simple example is a lady who has collected a sample of urine during menstrual periods. The second one is urine is red color, but it's not due to blood. It could be a patient who's taking any drug, which can, discolor the urine in red, like rifampicin taking patient, or else a person who has taken some food in excess, like some food coloring, like anthocyanin. So when you come to true hematuria, we can identify two important etiologies. The causes belong to us, we call urological causes, and the causes belong to the consultant nephrologist, it's called nephrologic causes. Now, urological hematuria also is called essential hematuria, and the etiology of urological or essential hematuria, we can again divide it into malignant causes and non-malignant causes. Now, from urological perspective, what we might mainly bother is to identify and not to miss these malignant causes, starting from the upper tracts, renal cell cancers, upper tract urothelial cancers, bladder cancers, prostate and the urethral cancers. Although may be more common, the non-malignant causes, Stone disease, benign prostatic hyperplasia, infections, vascular causes like pseudoaneurysms, obstructive uropathies, trauma, and infection. So why do we bother is simply we do not miss any urological malignancy underlying as the cause for hematuria. Now, among the patients with visible hematuria, in 20 to 40% of patients will harbor a urological neoplasm. Among the patients with microscopic hematuria, about 3 to 5% patients will harbor a urological neoplasm. So, when should we do the full workup when a patient coming with hematuria? Now, this is very important to keep in mind, even in your day-to-day and general practice. Any patient coming with any type of hematuria, visible or microscopic, if the age is more than 40 years. The second one is, if the patient having single episode of visible, that visible red color urine, irrespective of the age. The third category is single episode of symptomatic hematuria. Now, it could be pain-free, painless hematuria, various types that you can describe. But what we mean symptoms is mainly what we bother about the storage or the irritative type lower urinary tract symptoms. The dysuria, urgency, frequency, urge incontinence. Those could be the very first sign of an early bladder tumor. Or sometimes it could be an early sign of a high-grade bladder tumor in a situation called carcinoma in situ. So if the patient is coming with irritative lower urinary tract symptoms, then microscopic hematuria, we have to be very careful. Other thing is persistent asymptomatic microscopic hematuria. So evaluation, like in any other condition, is very simple: history, examination, and investigation. In the history, we had to ask the timing of hematuria, whether it's initial, throughout, or terminal, and what the duration of the hematuria that the patient has had. But associated symptoms, as I have mentioned, the presence of clots. Now, usually presence of clots indicates presence of a significant amount of bleeding into urinary tract. Usually they say for you to see slight little pinkish color in urine, you should get at least 1 milliliter of blood dissolved in 1 liter of urine. So it's a quite a significant amount. Presence of clot means definitely there's significant amount of bleeding, and intake of colored food or any drug that can discolor urine, trauma to urinary tract or the abdomen, bleeding from other side. To exclude pseudohematuria, you have to ask the causes like menstruation, taking sample of urine after exercise, sexual intercourse, and also history of bleeding disorders, presence of tuberculosis, past history, and traveling into countries with schistosomiasis, and presence of past history of stone disease. One of the important aspect of taking the history is for risk assessment. Risk assessment for what? Risk assessment for possible urological malignancy. So the family history, being a smoker, being a male more than 35 years of age, occupational exposure to chemicals, analgesic abuse, and any past history of visible hematuria, any past urological disease, irritative voiding symptoms, as I have mentioned, past pelvic irradiation, because post radiation sometimes can cause secondary tumors, the chronic infections, and sometimes the presence of chronic indwelling, it could be a foreign body like catheter, or else sometimes a bladder stone can result in a bladder malignancy. So the examination is starting with the vital signs. To look for pallor, the patient will be anemic due to a chronic bleed, checking for the cardiovascular parameters, and focus abdominal examination. It is very important in both sexes that we do a digital rectal examination, and in females that we do a vaginal examination. Now, coming to the laboratory investigations, the first step is to confirm the blood in urine. Now, we have to confirm in a urine full report, there are red cells. So, I mean, current day, there's a trend to use dipsticks, but the problem with dipsticks is they will become positive for not only for red cells, but just for hemoglobin and myoglobin as well. So, always it's advisable to take a sample of midstream urine and to send for formal urine full report. At the same time, we send a sample of urine for culture and ABST to exclude any concurrent infection. We always assess the baseline renal function and a full blood count just to see how the hemoglobin and platelets are. We routinely send a sample of urine for cytology just to see any malignant cells, the lab centrifuge, and look under the microscope. And we send a sample of urine for dysmorphic red cells. Now, while investigating, we have to keep in back in mind our mind the whether the bleeding could be due to any nephrologic cause. So history and examination sometimes may suggest patients may be having impaired renal functions. Presence of significant proteinuria is a very suggestive factor of underlying glomerular cause of bleeding. Because usually in urological causes, we do not get such amount of proteinuria. Bleeding due to stones, even tumors, we don't get proteinuria in the presence of normal renal functions. Presence of dysmorphic RBC and casts are always suggestive of glomerular type of bleeding. Now, if you perform this phase contrast microscopy, you can see the isomorphic normal red cells. In glomerular type of bleeding, you can see that red cells are dysmorphic. And also the presence of casts, all are suggestive of glomerular causes of bleeding. Now, what imaging can we do in assessment of hematuria? Now, if an exam question is asked, what is the gold standard imaging to assess hematuria? One single answer is the CT urogram or CTI view. So that is the standard test. But to the amount of patients that we get or to the amount of workload that the radiology department has, we are not going to bombard our radiology colleagues with all the patients. X-ray KUB combined with ultrasound KUB is good enough. And if it deems necessary only, we can later arrange CT urogram. Additionally, we can perform intravenous urograms and also MRIs. X-rays are good to detect presence of stones, but they need further evaluation. Now, ultrasound is very good because the specialties are freely available everywhere now, and it's non-invasive. It can detect renal tumors like that. It can detect soft tissue lesions filling the pellicular system suggestive of upper tract tumors. It can detect hydronephrosis, which need evaluation for the etiology. And if the bladder is distended enough and the lesion is large enough, you can detect bladder tumors as well. Intravenous urograms are not very commonly performed now, but if you do, you can see this kind of filling defects in the, it could be in the ureter, it could be in the pellicular system, suggestive of upper tract urothelial tumors. And in the bladder, again, if the lesion is large enough, you will see a filling defect in the bladder in case of a large bladder tumors. Gold standard, however, is the CT urogram. You can detect this kind of renal tumors. You can detect upper tract urothelial tumors filling the pellicular system and the upper urinary tract. Any other cause, like presence of complex renal cysts as cause for hematuria. Now, you can arrange all these things at your level, but how can we, urologists, help in evaluation of hematuria? That is by performing the last step of evaluation, the cystoscopy. That is to assess the lower urinary tract, because all those investigations and imagings mentioned can miss a very tiny lesion inside the bladder, especially a small tumor or carcinoma inside too, that we can recognize only by doing the cystoscopy. Additionally, to assess the upper tracts, we perform retrograde pyelogram. We can perform ureteroscopies and biopsies, and also to obtain cytology with taking brushings. So cystoscopy will detect this kind of a papillary, or on your right-hand side is a solid bladder tumor. Retrograde pyelogram is a scenario we do. We insert a small ureteric catheter into the particular ureteric orifice, and we then inject contrast. Then you can see the filling defects in the upper urinary tract. Then we perform the ureteroscopy up to that particular lesion. You can see the bleeding suspicious lesions like this, and we can take biopsies and take brushings for cytology. Now, again, there's a problem. Having done all this full assessment, some percentage of patients become negative in all the investigations. So what you will do? Or no, you will not be able to find anything. Now, these category, we label them as benign hematuria. But problem is 80% of gross hematuria patients, later they have found 18% of them will develop a urological malignancy. So you don't discharge them. You follow them up at intervals of 6 months, 12 months, at 1 year, at the end of 2 years and 3 years, with just checking midstream sample of urine, just a UFR. At the end of 3 years, UFR remains normal, you discharge them. In patients with microscopic hematuria, there's a less 3% chance of developing a tumor within the next 5 years. So you just follow them up with annual checking of midstream urine just for 2 years. Now, during follow-up, if these patients develop these things, any gross hematuria, irritative lower tract symptoms or worsening of renal functions, they need to be evaluated in the same line that we have mentioned previously. Just a little word about hematuria in children. Now, these kids should be assessed by a consultant pediatrician, and after necessary investigation, they can be referred to a urologist if they identify it as necessary. During pregnancy, they need obstetric assessment by a consultant obstetrician. Now, the good thing about hematuria in pregnancy is most of the time causes are benign, like stone disease, infections. But very rarely, there can be life-threatening causes like placenta perfuta, where the placental villi has gone through the bladder, which causes gross hematuria. There are rare occasions, case reports of incidents where the kidneys have ruptured during pregnancy. But to my knowledge, in Sri Lanka, we have not encountered any. So when you get a patient with gross hematuria, which always is a problem in both surgical and medical wards, how would you approach? Now, just check whether the patient is having any coagulopathy and stop any anticoagulants that the patient is taking. Check whether the patient is hemodynamically stable, transfused as necessary with cross-matching blood. If there's significant bleeding or clot retention, we have to manually wash out the bladder, what you call hand irrigate the bladder, evacuate all the clots, and then put the patient on a three-way catheter and commence on continuous bladder irrigation. That is to prevent further clot formation. If it is prostatic origin bleeding, you can apply gentle catheter traction to compress the prostate with a white catheter balloon. And if bleeding persists, they need cystoscopy by urological team. After all investigations, as you have mentioned, then we have to treat the underlying cause. Now, the kidney bleeding, if the expertise are available, interventional radiologists, we can request them to do the embolization, like in a case of angiomyolipoma bleeding. Or else, we have to surgically do partial or total nephrectomy for a case of tumor. Prostate bleeding, we can try with thrombotic agents, tranexamic acid. Now, we commonly use androgen deprivation, initially with 5-alpha reductase inhibitors, finasteride and dutasteride. And then, in cases of both cancer prostates bleeding and benign prostate problematically bleeding, we use GnRH analogs. Just a single shot, most of the time, cures the prostatic bleeding. We can consider the transurethral resection and electrocautery, selective embolization if the expert is available. Bladder bleeding, again, initial management, we can try with tranexamic acid, transurethral resection or electrocautery. As a palliative measure, now, we get a lot of our cancer patients with bladder malignancies. On palliative care, as a last step, we instill coagulative agents like very low concentrate formalin, aluminium hydroxide, and silver nitrate to coagulate those bleeding points. There's a place for hyperbaric oxygen, especially both as malignancies as well as post-radiation bladder bleeding. We place the patient in a hyperbaric oxygen chamber at a pressure of 2 to 3 atmospheres, and let them inhale 100% oxygen for a period of 1 to 2 hours. They have found it increases the vascularity, increases the formation of granulation tissue, enhances healing, thereby stop bleeding. Now, summary of evaluation steps in hematuria, just to recall what we have discussed already. So assess whether it's true or pseudo hematuria. Once the true hematuria is confirmed, you assess the patient with history and examination. Very simple, just 4 urine tests, the full report, the culture and ABST. Send a sample of urine for cytology and a sample of urine for dysmorphic carbase. Always assess baseline creatinine, at the same time do a full blood count. Then you image it. CT urogram is gold standard, always good if you can arrange. If not, X-ray KUB combined with ultrasound kidney ureter bladder is good enough. The last step, please let them have, let us have a look inside the bladder. It's always worth performing cystoscopy. So the take-home messages: all hematuria will not be due to urinary tract infections or stones. Whether it's visible or microscopic hematuria, that may be the very first sign of a serious urological malignancy. So the patients need a systematic assessment and referral to a urological center for the further evaluation. Now, presence of positive finding other than a malignancy does not preclude need for other investigation. Now, for example, 60-year-old gentleman coming with single episode of visible hematuria, X-ray KB, you have a stone. That doesn't mean patient does not need a cystoscopy. They need. The other situation is commonly we get now a lot of patients, elderly now taking dual antiplatelets, come with hematuria, you think it's prosthetic origin bleeding. No, we have to do the full evaluation. Patients with negative workup, as we have mentioned, they need follow-up. We just don't discharge them. We follow up for 2 to 3 years. And always we should obtain nephrology opinion if the hematuria seems to be nephrological in origin. So always we should respect the findings of the urine full report. So don't disregard the presence of more than 3 per high power field red cells. So always do the full assessment in all the necessary cases. Thank you very much.